cause me to come to your river, O Lord. Cause me to come to your river, O Lord. Cause me to come to your river, O Lord. Cause me to come, cause me to drink, cause me to live. Speak, Lord, your word, I am listening to you. Speak, Lord, your word, I am listening to you. Speak, Lord, your word, I am listening to you. Speak to my mind, speak to my will, speak to my heart.
Good morning, friends, and welcome to this great celebration of God's love, that is the Eucharist. This Mass is offered for the following intentions. For the soul of Salvador de Silva, soul of Prakash Parke, soul of Prema Kohli, first death anniversary, soul of Santan Salvador Pereira, thanksgiving to Jesus, thanksgiving to the Holy Family, soul of Arthur de Souza, soul of Peter Mendonca, soul of Regina Mendonca, soul of Jerome Mendonca, soul of Angeline de Costa, soul of Gilbert de Costa, souls in purgatory, soul of Anita Sequeira, and the deceased members of Pinto family. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
The parable of today, of the wicked tenants, reminds us that we are nothing without God. We are nothing without Christ. He is the vine, and we are the branches. We need to remain united in Him, in prayer, and through the life that we live. For the times that we have rejected His friendship, we ask Him for pardon. You were sent to heal the contrite of heart, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners, Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
We will now sing the Gloria.
Glory, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, Heavenly King, O God Almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in the glory of God the Father. Amen, amen, amen.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who in the abundance of your kindness surpass the merits and the desires of those who entreat you, pour out your mercy upon us to pardon what conscience dreads and to give what prayer does not dare to ask. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God for ever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. Let me sing to my friend the song of his love for his vineyard. My friend had a vineyard on a fertile hillside. He dug the soil, cleared it of stones, and planted choice vines in it. In the middle, he built a tower. He dug a press there too. He expected it to yield grapes, but sour grapes were all that it gave. And now, inhabitants of Jerusalem and men of Judah, I ask you to judge between my vineyard and me. What could I have done for my vineyard that I have not done? I expected it to yield grapes. Why did it yield sour grapes instead? Very well. It will tell you what I am going to do to my vineyard. I will take away its edge for it to be grazed on, and knock down its wall for it to be trampled on. I will lay it waste, unpruned, undug, overgrown by the briar and the thorn. I will command the clouds to rain no rain on it. Yes, the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the men of Judah, that chosen plant. He expected justice, but found bloodshed, integrity, but only a cry of distress. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our responsorial psalm is, the vineyard of the Lord is the house of Israel.
The vineyard of the Lord is the house of Israel.
You brought a vine out of Egypt. You planted it, you drove out the nations. It stretched out its branches on the sea. To the great river it stretched out its shoots.
The vineyard of the Lord is a house of Israel.
Then why have you broken down its walls? It is plucked by all who pass by. It is ravaged by the boar of the forest, devoured by the beast of the field.
The vineyard of the Lord is a house of Israel.
God of hosts, turn again, we implore. Look down from heaven and see. Visit this vine and protect it, the vine your right hand has planted.
The vineyard of the Lord is the house of Israel.
And we shall never forsake you again. Give us life that we may call upon your name. God of hosts, bring us back. Let your face shine on us and we shall be saved.
The vineyard of the Lord is the house of Israel.
A reading from the letter of Saint Paul to the Philippians. There is no need to worry, but if there is anything you need, pray for it, asking God for it with prayer and thanksgiving, and that peace of God, which is so much greater than we can understand, will guard your hearts and your thoughts in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, fill your mind with everything that is true, everything that is noble, everything that is good and pure, everything that we love and honor, and everything that can be thought virtuous of worthy praise. Keep doing all the things that you learned from me and have been taught by me and have heard or seen that I do. Then the God of peace will be with you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Kindly rise for the gospel.
Hallelujah.
I call you friends, says the Lord, because I have made known to you everything I have learned from my Father.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to the chief priests and the elders of the people, "Listen to another parable. There was a man, a landowner, who planted a vineyard. He fenced it round, dug a winepress in it, and built a tower. Then he leased it to tenants and went abroad. When vintage time drew near, he sent his servants to the tenants to collect his produce. But the tenants seized his servants, thrashed one, killed another, and stoned a third. Next he sent some more servants, this time a larger number, and they dealt with them in the same way. Finally he sent his son to them. 'They will respect my son,' he said. But when the tenants saw the son, they said to each other, 'This is the heir. Come on, let us kill him and take his inheritance.' So they seized him and threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. Now, when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants?" They answered, "He will bring those wretches to a wretched end and lease the vineyard to other tenants who will deliver the produce to him when the season arrives." Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures? It was the stone rejected by the builders that became the keystone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is wonderful to see. I tell you then, that the kingdom of God will be taken from you and given to a people who will produce its fruits." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Last week, while reflecting on the parable of the two sons, we saw how Jesus was now targeting the leaders, that is, the chief priests, the Pharisees, the elders, and the scribes, for not accepting his message. By doing so, they were trying to kill the truth. Jesus always said, "I speak the truth." And I also told you that in the next few weeks, we have to keep this backdrop in mind. And the backdrop is the Holy Week. Jesus entering into Jerusalem. A few days are left. There is urgency in the message of Jesus. This is what we will see. All these parables, there is an urgency in the message of Jesus. "Turn away and listen to me, and you will inherit the kingdom of God," he was constantly telling them. Jesus had told Pilate during the trial. Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into this world." This is what Jesus said. "To testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." And that is why I said, these people were trying to kill the truth. By killing Jesus, by trying to silence him, they were trying to silence the truth. But Jesus came for this, to reveal the truth. Jesus was, as if to say, offering to them a chance, a final chance. As I said, the Holy Week, a few days are left. They either have to accept him or be doomed. So the parable of today is the continuation of the message of last Sunday's parable. How do we know this? The passage of today's gospel begins this way. Listen to another parable. So, the first parable has a message. Now the same message I'm giving to another parable. So listen to another parable. The parable gets to the root of the issue of disobedience of the Jews, mainly their leaders, how they were disobedient from the beginning. To understand this message with clarity, clearly, we need to read it along with the first reading of today, the reading of Isaiah. Israel was the chosen vine, we are told. In verse 7 of today's first reading, very clear, for the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the men of Judah are his pleasing planting, rich. Sarvashaktishali Yehova ka angur ka bagicha Israel ka rashtra hai. Aur angur ki belen jine Yehova prem karta hai, Yehuda ke log hai. The people of Israel, people of Judah. So they are the chosen ones. How do we know this? We know the story of the Exodus. How God brought them out of Egypt and planted them in the promised land. It took quite some time for God to take them to that promised land, but he was preparing them. It was not only taking them from one place and planting them in another place. There would have been chaos, we are told. But he took great care to prepare them. In the book of Deuteronomy, Moses, before they could enter into this promised land, he's reminding them once again, don't forget the covenant that God has made with you. Obey his commandments, walk with him, and you will be fruitful. You will have life. So, what Moses told them was, I put before you, God is putting before you life and death. You have to choose. Choose life. The entire struggle we see in this land of Canaan, initially it was, everything was good. But then we are told something happened. People, we are told, when they were planted there, they did not, or they stopped listening to God. How do you know this? You see, a vineyard, it is not only you plant that vineyard and then it will grow. A lot of caring is required for this vineyard. That is what is expressed in today's parable. Lot of caring is required in, you know, nurturing that vineyard. And we are told that God did all that. Because in the first reading today, verses 1 and 2 tells us that God planted a perfect vineyard. A vineyard which had boundaries. Very important, because outsiders, animals and others would come and attack. Then he had a wine press in that vineyard. He had a tower, watchtower from there. All normally they had in this vineyard watchtowers to make sure that, you know, to see. They could see from, you know, distance and make sure that everything is safe. All that. And then we are told he leased it. That is, it was given to the leaders to take care. So, when they were taken to the promised land, a perfect place for them to live, we are told it was a land flowing with milk and honey. Enough for us to understand when he said land flowing with milk and honey means, wow, what a land, everything found. And so Isaiah tells us today very clearly that God planted a perfect Israel into a perfect vineyard, everything found. They did not have to worry. And then it was given to the leaders, leased up to the leader. The tenants are the so-called leaders of these Israelites. What was their job? Their job was to take care of this vineyard. As I said, lot of caring is required for this vineyard to grow and bear proper quality fruit. The owner is God now. In the parable, we understand the owner is God. And being God, and he planting the vineyard, obviously he has the right to seek fruit. God expected Israel to bear good fruit. But it did not bear good fruit. Human nature is such that we make mistakes in life. No problem. God doesn't have problem with that. We may make mistakes, we sin, we lose our way. But then the problem is this. When God corrects us, we don't listen to Him. The parable tells us this. What does it tell us? He sent servants. Few servants to get the fruit. God is owner. He expected them to bear fruit. So He sent, but they were growing wild. We are told if a vineyard is not taken care of properly, a lot of pruning is required. If it is not pruned properly, then it will grow wild. And wild vineyard will bear sour fruit, sour grapes. And so you will always see people who own the vineyard every day. It is their job every day to go and prune, to go and check, to find out, is there anything not proper? They'll have to cut even the grapes if they are, you know, rotten, and then they have to, you know, very carefully cut so that it doesn't affect the others. So much is there in the vineyard. There is a lot of care to be taken. And we are told God took that care. Whenever they were growing wild, means they were not listening, God sent the prophets. Then He sent some more prophets, we are told. And finally, we are told He sent His Son. Why? At least they will listen to My Son. Jesus always spoke to them that I have come from the Father. What I reveal to you is what I have heard from the Father. So He is the Son who reveals the truth to these Israelites. But they did not listen, we are told. What did they do? They first of all stoned and killed the prophets. They did not listen to them, we are told. Isaiah, today's reading, no? How did Isaiah die? They sewed him into two pieces. You see, they cut him into two pieces. Jeremiah was killed. Prophets were stoned. That means God was sending messengers to them to tell them, to show them where they are going wrong. But the problem was they did not listen to them. And finally, we are told in today's parable, they sent the Son. And they threw the Son out of the vineyard. Not only threw Him out, they killed Him. And this is the prophecy. Jesus was not crucified in Jerusalem. He was crucified outside Jerusalem on Mount Golgotha. All prophecies coming through. So the entire chapter of chapter 5, if you read, to understand how Israel went wild. Okay, we have read a few things. But if you read the entire chapter 5, we will know how Israel was growing wild. By not listening, there was injustice, there was sin, disobedience. They were doing, each one was doing what he wanted to do. And because the message of the prophets did not match their understanding of life, they wanted to do away with them. In doing that, they did away with God. They did not realize that they were disobeying God. So after that, Jesus is asking them now. They did not respect the servants, then more servants, even the Son they killed. Now He's asking them a question. What do you think that the landowner will now do? He's asking them a question. And they answer, this is what they answer. He will put those wretches to a miserable death and let out the vineyard to other tenants. Because these tenants did not, who was supposed to take care of Israel, they did not do that. So God will now reject them. And then He will give this vineyard to another tenant. Who is this another tenant? We'll see. Therefore, I'll tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a nation producing fruits. I will give it to someone who will produce fruit. Here is the connection. When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard this, they knew, they understood that He was talking about them. And that is why they wanted to kill Him. The rejection was complete. With the killing of Jesus, the rejection was complete. But that was not the end. It was a new beginning. We are told that was the old covenant, end of the old covenant. But now God was making a new covenant through his son. And a new Israel was born. Who is this new Israel? Is Christianity. Okay? The church. The church is the new Israel. The old Israel was disobedient. And so God has now taken this vineyard and given to a new people. And these new people are the church, the new church. So, we are the new Israel. You and I are the new Israel. We are the people of the new covenant. The parable has a lot to teach us now. We must understand. Yes, they were the chosen ones. They rejected. God rejected them. Now, we are the chosen ones. We have to consider ourselves as the chosen ones. And so, this parable makes a lot of sense. We have to reflect and see what happened to them should not happen to us. And so, we are called to bear fruit. That is what we are told. Jesus always. What is this fruit that we are called to bear? We constantly we are told, you must bear fruit, you must bear fruit, you must bear fruit. We must understand what kind of fruit is God expecting from this new Israel. Jesus had told his disciples that they are to be his witnesses to the whole world. I use this word again and again. See, the church cannot be, static. It has to be dynamic, because the church was chosen to be a witness. What is a witness? I explained last time. What is a witness? A witness is the one who testifies to the truth. See, again, I'm coming to the truth. So we who know the truth have to reveal. The same was expected of the Israelites. No, to be witnesses. God did not choose them. When he put them in this new place, the promised land, he expected them to be a witness. God's expectation was this, that others will see. We have so many quotations. Others will see and say, wow, what a people, what a God they must be having. You know, by looking at them, they should praise God. That was the expectation of God from the Israelites, but they failed. You and I can also fail. We also, when Jesus, after his resurrection, just before his ascension, what did he tell them? You will be my witnesses to the ends of the earth. To the ends of the earth. So, my dear friends, witness is dynamic, not static. We should not be happy just by... So, we are called to bear fruit by being witnesses of the gospel. Our lives should reflect the gospel of Jesus. That is what we are told. To be fruitful witnesses, we require the following. I am giving you a few things, concise. First is being open to constant pruning. I told you, the vineyard, when once it is planted, you cannot just leave it like that. Human nature is such. This is, in a parable, is a way of a story telling us about our nature. Human nature is like that. We forget. We tend to forget. And we tend to forget and disobey sometimes. We go. We like it. But then there are chances that we go here and there, sometimes make some mistakes. So what is important is pruning. We must be open to pruning. John chapter 15. You read the entire chapter, but verse 1 to 5 I read. I am the true vine and the Father is the vine dresser. Every branch of mine that bears no fruit, he takes away. We will be like the Israelites. And every branch that does not bear fruit, he prunes. And it may, so that, why does he prune? So that it may bear fruit. So that's why I said we must be open to pruning. If you are not open to pruning, we will grow wild. Correct? You are all, now Jesus is telling them, what is pruning for them? You are already made clean by the word which I have spoken to you. Word. The word that Jesus spoke was pruning. Was a process of pruning. Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. That is what Jesus says. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. Very clearly, he is telling the disciples, don't make the same mistakes that these Israelites made. They thought they can go on their own. They went wild. And look what happened to them. Destruction. They were taken into exile. people from outside came and captured them and made them slaves for so many times, so many years, and yet they were not listening. This should not happen to you. So first thing is pruning, being open to pruning. Now, second is prayer. Why I use second as prayer? Because this pruning which I am talking about can best happen in prayer. Now what prayer? I always harp. I am using this word. I always harp on contemplative prayer, not vocal prayer. Vocal prayer will not make any difference. Pruning will happen only in contemplative prayer. What is contemplative prayer? I read the Gospels and I reflect and I say, yes, Lord, yes, you say I must not be angry, but I am an angry person. Do something. I open my anger to you. Please prune it, remove it. Help me to work out this whole negative thing that I have in my life. Anger, greed, all those things. So pruning can take place in prayer. So prayer is important. We learn from Mary. When the angel appeared to Mary, and what did Mary say? Behold, I am the handmaid of the Lord. Let it be according to me, according to your word. Word, again, word, word of God. And the last is by our life. Now you see, I can read, I can contemplate, but the way we live will determine the quality of our witness. We may read, but our life should match what we read and what we pray. And so we are told that if we want to be good witnesses, then what should happen? We need to live the word in our life. Last week I ended with something, and this week also I will end with the same. Let us walk the talk. Amen. Let us make the profession of faith.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of
the body and life everlasting. Amen.
We now lift up our petitions to the Lord. Our response will be, Lord, teach us to bear good fruit in our lives. And I repeat,
Lord, teach us to bear good fruit in our life.
For the Pope, the bishops, priests and the religious, that as leaders of the church they may turn the minds and hearts of people towards God who call on them, we pray.
Lord, teach us to bear good fruit in our lives.
That Christians may remain attached to Christ their master and produce abundant fruit in their lives, we pray.
Lord, teach us to bear good fruit in our lives.
That Christians may hold fast to the faith they have received and live it with ardor, despite of opposition and persecution in this world, we pray.
Lord, teach us to bear good fruit in our life.
We pray for all those affected by the virus, that your healing touch may bring them back to health, we pray.
Lord, teach us to bear good fruit in our life.
We pray for our personal needs and the needs of all who have asked us to pray for. We pray.
Lord, teach us to bear good fruit in our lives.
Lord, as we endure pain and suffering due to the pandemic, may we always look to you in hope. Give to us all that we need. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands, it will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual ring.
Blessed be God forever.
Pray, my dear brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept this sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Accept, O Lord, we pray, the sacrifices instituted by your commands and through the sacred mysteries which we celebrate with dutiful service. Graciously complete the sanctifying work by which you are pleased to redeem us. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For we know it belongs to your boundless glory that you came to the aid of mortal beings with your divinity and even fashioned for us a remedy out of mortality itself, that the cause of our downfall might become the means of our salvation through Christ our Lord. Through him, the host of angels adores your majesty and rejoices in your presence forever. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in one chorus of exultant praise as we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Holy is the Lord. Blessed, blessed is he comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Holy is the Lord.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is a chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Oswald, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the Blessed Apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from all evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
With your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof. But only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
An act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. Let us pray. Grant us, Almighty God, that we may be refreshed and nourished by the sacrament which we have received, so as to be transformed into what we consume. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Your spirit.
May Almighty God bless all of us, Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Almighty and merciful God, who show your love to all creation everywhere, hear graciously the prayers we make for all those affected by the coronavirus in various parts of the world. We come before you asking for a quick control of the outbreak, for a healing of those affected, for the victims and their families. We pray for the doctors doing research that an effective vaccine to combat the sickness is speedily found. We pray for the government and health authorities that they take appropriate steps for the good of the people. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Great things happen when God mixed with us. Great things happen when God mixed with us. Great and beautiful, wonderful things. Great things happen when God mixed with us. Some find life, some find peace. Some people also find joy. Some see things as they never could before. And some people find that they can now begin to trust. Great things happen when God mixed with us. Great things happen when God mixed with us. Great and beautiful, wonderful things. Great things happen when God mixed with us.